hear what God is doing in their lives. I think we have a week to catch up with the children. I don't know how long Amit is here. He's saying he's leaving today. I am overwhelmed. My train of thought is somewhat kind of lost, but God has a purpose in speaking to us through everything. And I thank God for the testimony. And I remember the verse which says, what the locusts have eaten, the Lord will give back. Not single portion, but double portion. So I'm waiting for a bigger testimony of a better race and a transfer back to Bangalore. So we've been studying something over the past 2-3 weeks. Yeah, somebody's... Can we have... So somebody seems to be very ministered to by design. Anything else you remember what we did? Authority, okay. So we are talking about biblical life principles, and we are doing a series which talks about how we should live life. These are not rules, but these are guidelines that are set by God. And today we will study a little bit more about what will happen when we don't follow these guidelines. Okay? Your soul is saved. We believe that God has come, shed his blood, and saved our souls for eternity. But that doesn't mean we can do whatever we want and nothing will happen to us. There are certain principles we live by. And if we live by those principles, we will live a purposeful life that God will shape us for eternity. If we squander our lives doing anything we want, then your soul will still be saved because Christ shed his blood for you. You still will live a miserable, sad life. Okay? So before we get into that, we spoke about biblical principles. There are 7 principles, and we did design, and we started on authority. We did a very little bit of authority last week, and today we are going to do authority and responsibility. I'm going to go through fast. I think these are concepts that we already know, but there are Bible verses which put together, and God will speak to you through that and what we need to change in our lives. Design, authority, responsibility. Can we go to the next? Oh, I have the thing. Okay, sorry. Okay. Design, authority, responsibility, suffering, ownership, freedom, and success. Okay? And we will go through each of these. Hopefully we'll finish these two today, and over the next 2 or 3 weeks we will finish the rest of it. So last week we did authority, and I'm not switching off this light because last week I got some live feedback. Do you know what live feedback is? When you switch off the light and people are all tired from the week, you know what happens. That is what was live feedback. So I'm going to leave the light on so people can be bright and awake and listening to what God wants to speak to you. Okay, we spoke about... We spoke about authority last week, and we read that there is no authority on earth that is not put by God. So every authority on earth is put by God, and this is very apt at the moment because there is so much of chaos going on, and everybody is either scared of who is going to come to power and or terrified of what will happen to their faith and church and all those things. And God says, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Whoever comes to rule, God has put that person in place. Okay, I still don't know who is actually on the chief minister, but whoever is put there, God has put in place. And we have to be subject to that authority in Christ. So we read about this, and we studied a little bit about why we don't like authority. Why do we not like authority? Why do we not like authority? Children, why do you not like somebody else telling you what to do? Yeah, because we want to do whatever we feel like. Yeah? What else? What else? Anybody remembers why you don't want authority? Very nice. My God, Isaac remembers my sermon. He says, the person who is telling you to do the things might not be fair. Okay? We often think the authority is not wise enough or good enough. Or, we did this. All of us have problems with authority. Okay, it's changing color. I'm not pressing buttons to change color, but it's... Okay. I think one color is enough than this. Yeah, it's okay. So authority is because we lose control, and we also know that authority in human form is fallen and corrupt. So human form authority is always going to be bad. Is there a perfect leader? Nobody is a perfect leader. Okay? And we don't trust the legitimacy of the authority. Okay? We are still fighting who should be the chief minister. We don't think he was rightly elected. And all kinds of things. So we find all kinds of these excuses to disobey authority. I'm skimming through all this. Okay. Okay. Biblically, should we always submit? And we said yes, as long as we don't have to directly, blatantly disobey Christ. If somebody says renounce Christ, that you don't have to obey. But everything else, you obey. Okay? Okay, the color has become okay. We also saw something called the umbrella of protection. So there is an umbrella of protection when you stay under authority. And when you go out of authority, you lose the covering that God has placed over your life. And because of which, you might end up in trouble. So it is always good to remain under the protective umbrella of the authority that God has placed in your life. Okay, and there are several authorities, we will get to that. And the best example is what we have been worshipping and talking about today. There is this prodigal son who is happily living in the father's house. He decides, I don't need to obey my dad. I don't need to listen to all the things that he says. I don't need to go work in the farm every day like my stupid older brother. I would rather go out and have fun. There is so much money. And all I'm doing is sitting and watching this money grow. And I'm not using it. And by the time I find use for it, I will be too old to enjoy anything. So let me take my money now from my dad and let me go enjoy my life. This is what he thought. And what happened? The moment he lost the protection of the authority of the father, he was taken over by his friends who squandered his wealth for him, and he also squandered the wealth, and in the end he was eating pig food. Okay, and actually he didn't even get to eat pig food. He wished he ate pig food, and then he realizes this is much worse than the servants in my father's house, and I will go back. And thankfully we have a father who is willing to take us back. He's not just willing to take us back, like Aldina was saying, he's all with all the doubts that you have. You know, this guy had all kinds of doubts when he was turning back. But the father was waiting, watching out for him. And there was somebody who said that it is impossible that the father by chance was looking out and saw his son coming far off. Every day this father was waiting, looking for the son. Okay, and I want to read something. When we were singing about this song, singing the song Reckless Love, this is a new song, but there is a older poem which was written, I think, about more than 150 years ago, called Hound of Heaven. Anybody's heard Hound of Heaven by Francis Thompson? I'm just going to, it's a very, very long poem. I'm just going to read one paragraph of it and then go to the next one. It says, I fled him. Down the nights and down the days, I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinth ways of my own mind and in the midst of tears. I hid from him and under running laughter, up vistaed hopes I sped. I shot and precipitated. adorn titanic glooms of chastened fears. And he goes on and on, and he explains how he was running away from God. And he is talking about the hound of heaven, which means it's actually a hound is a dog. No, this dog from heaven, which was chasing him and chasing him and chasing him. As much as he ran away from God, there was this dog which was chasing him. And in the end, it catches him and it says, and Francis has lost, I have stored for thee at home. Rise, clasp my hand and come. Halt by me that footfall is my gloom after all. Shade of his hand outstretched caressingly. Ah, fondest, blindest, weakest, I am he whom thou seekest. Thou dravest love from thee who dravest me. This is a little old in English, but it just says, God comes and finally gets hold of you. And he says, all that you've been running from is all that you need. So stop running and turn to me. And this is a song which is very similar to this reckless love and know what Alina shared this morning about communion. And this is the God we have, even when we got out of the umbrella of protection. So probably now you're in a place in your life where you've got out of your authority that God has placed in your life. And it is always time to go back under it. God is always willing to restore what you've lost in your life. Okay? So we spoke about a little bit about world's principle on, okay, this is, okay, the colors are not changing. The world's principle is about freedom is, you get freedom when you rebel from authority. There is authority, and the moment you rebel, you get freedom. And there are all kinds of things. Like Isaac said, I should be free to do whatever I want. There are lots of songs. If you look at the history of music, in the 1960s and 70s, where the hippie culture took over, it was all about freedom. Okay? And it is all about, no, it's my life, I will do whatever I want to do. There are many, many songs. And this is not stopped. This is, even now, I was reading a blog and then there somebody said this. I no longer look at it as me having a problem with authority, but I have a problem, dislike for inequality and injustice. Okay? So apparently any problem that I have, I can say that I dislike inequality and injustice, so I will not obey any authority at all. Okay? This is the common thought. Anybody outside, you go say you have a problem with authority, nobody will accept it. Does anybody like it if I come and tell you you have a problem with authority? You will find an excuse to justify why you have a problem with authority. And it's not one person, all of us have problems with authority. Okay, so what is this rebellion that we have? There is a overt rebellion and there is a subtle rebellion. And the subtle rebellion is something that we know, we spoke about. Overt rebellion we all know about protests and things. The subtle rebellion is the helmet which George showed. If you have a helmet, actually it's a good thing to display and show. Anybody has a helmet here? You have a helmet? Is there a helmet? David, instead of me wearing your helmet, can you come and wear your helmet? So there is one before you wear. Hold on. There are people who wear their helmet like this. Okay? That is, I don't know why, I think when they see a cop, they somehow maneuver and get their head instead of their elbow into it. But there is a way in which you obey the law. How do you do it? By wearing the helmet, like that. Yes, that is obeying the law, okay? Now, there are people who have these half helmets, which already is kind of, no, I feel there is no point in wearing those half helmets. And then there are two straps dangling, which keep flying in the back, okay? And even a speed breaker bump, the helmet will fall off before they fall off. So, and there's no point wearing something like that. What is interesting is George's observation. Can you remove the strap? and your glasses probably. You can't do that today. And wear it. Yeah, like that. No, 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 stop. Yeah. There are people who wear helmets like this. Okay? They are obeying the law. Are they not obeying the law? You can never make out. Okay, thank you for spoiling your hairstyle. So it is this kind of subtle rebellion we all have. No, this is helmet example is something very simple. The other thing that we have is we are sitting in a meeting at work. What do? On your cell phone. Okay? And it's not difficult for your boss to notice the subtle rebellion in there. You bring your laptop. It's so we in our company we have a policy when we go for meetings we're not supposed to take our laptops. But still, most of us take our laptops because we think we are doing something more important than the meeting. And we'll be working. These are all subtle rebellions. You are in some way your heart is not truly in obedience to the authority that is there. You want to say that I am better than the authority above me. Okay? And I'm going to give you two scary examples from the Bible which talk about this rebellion. Okay, so one of the examples is the Israelites walking in the desert, and the first sign of rebellion is murmuring. What is murmuring? Complaining. Okay? How many of us complain? All of us complain about everything. The only conversation we have about life is complaints. There is nothing happy ever that happens in your life. If you ask anybody, how are you? Going on. How's your work? It's okay. How's your boss? Oh man, don't ask. Everything is a complaint. There is nothing that seems to be happy. And this is the first sign, okay? This you can read in Numbers 14 where how they rebelled against Moses and Aaron. I want to go into a little bit more into this. Anybody knows Korah? How many of you know Korah? Okay, a few people have heard about this guy called Korah. What did he do? Any of you know who he is? He was one of the leaders with Moses. Moses was leading the Israelites out. Korah was a co-leader, a person who was leading with Moses. But what happened to Korah? He got jealous of Moses. And you know, Korah complained about something in Moses which God had testified for Moses. Korah said Moses was proud. Korah told people that Moses thinks that God can speak only to him and not to anybody else. Aren't we all the same? Aren't we all the people of God that God chose? And Korah went and murmured. And along with him, there were 250 other people who joined and started murmuring. And this was kind of essentially jealousy. And can we read Numbers 16? So I'm going to read Numbers 16 verses 1 to 3. Korah, son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, and certain Reubenites, Dathan and Abiram, sons of Eliab, and on sons of Peleth, became insolent and rose up against Moses. With them were 250 Israelite men, well-known community leaders who had been appointed members of the council. They came as a group to oppose Moses and Aaron and said to them, "You have gone too far. The whole community is holy, every one of them, and the Lord is with them. Why then do you set yourselves above the Lord's assembly?" Can you see his rebellion? It sounds all very reasonable. What Korah says is very reasonable. He says all of us are equal. Why are you considering yourself above the rest of us? The problem is Moses did not consider himself above the rest of the people. But Moses had a role that was above and had authority over the people. Moses had a role to play. Moses had respect for the role. Moses did not actually have too much respect for himself. He actually was a guy who did not want to go. When God called Moses, he said, please not me, anybody else not me. I am not the guy to go. And the last straw of that was when God finally told Moses, okay, I will give you another guy who will speak for you. You know when God said that? Moses keeps talking to God and God gives all these signs. And then in the end Moses says, I am useless, I cannot speak, I cannot do anything. And then in the end he says, even you, after you have spoken to me, I am still unfit. He tells God that, God, even you cannot change me. Even after you have spoken, I am still as unfit as I was before you called me. So please send somebody else. That is when God says, okay, I will give you somebody else. That was God's plan B, so to speak. It was not God's original plan to have Aaron. And because of what Aaron coming in, what happened? There was all kinds of chaos that followed. That meek a person was told that he was proud. And Korah rebelled against Moses by murmuring, primarily because of jealousy. Okay? So this is one thing that happens, and I've written here front-end ministry. This happens often in several of the things that we do. There are front-end ministry and there are roles that front-end ministry people do, and the roles have respect. There are elders in the church, several of us, and there are roles that you need to respect. Okay, and you don't need to respect, because of the role you'll have to respect the person, otherwise the person is just as anybody else. There is no respect needed for that person separately. But because of the role they play, because they are elders in the church, there is a respect that they need. And when we speak against them, this is not happening now, this has happened before, people speak against the elders in the church, there is an issue there. And you can see several examples. There is a good example of David. David had an opportunity to kill Saul. Saul had already fallen and David was supposed to be king, and Saul is chasing to kill David. But David, when he gets an opportunity, he doesn't kill and he says, how can I touch the Lord's anointed? David still had respect for the role. He did not say, how can I kill Saul? He was such a good man. That was not what David said. David said, how can I touch the Lord's anointed? So there was respect for the role that was given. So even in our lives, when there is authority above us, there is a respect for the person that you give, but that doesn't have to be for a special person. This person is so good, so I will respect this person. That is not what you need to do. There is a role which they play, and the respect is for the role, because the role is assigned by who? By God. So the respect, when you respect the role, it is God who we respect. The other example that I want to give is Saul. And we spoke about this a little bit last time. Saul was the first king of Israel, okay? And he was very handsome. He was a foot taller than anybody else in Israel. And he was not just physically better than anybody else, he was also emotionally better and very mature. Very mature. When Saul became king, some people mocked him. You know what? There is a verse in the Bible which says, it's beautiful. It says, Saul walked away as if he did not hear him. This happens when Saul has been anointed king, he's been declared king, and he's walking with his troops, literally. And when he's walking with his troops, there is another guy who is literally a nobody in Israel, who looks at Saul and starts cursing him and says, you are a useless fellow. You are good for nothing. How can you be the king? And when he says all these things and he's throwing stones and dust at Saul, the troop with Saul turns to Saul and says, give me, say yes, and I will kill this dog. That is the word that the troop uses. The troop says, say yes, and I will kill this dog. And Saul, what does he say? He goes as if he did not hear anything. And in English, it's not, the flavor doesn't come out. When you read it in Tamil, it says, Avan kaadu kelaadavan pol sendran, which means he walked as if he was a deaf person. Okay? How we wish sometimes we had that gift. When people are throwing dust at us, if we can walk as if we were deaf. This Saul, okay, this guy who was more mature, better than anybody else, who was anointed the first king of Israel, falls because of something. And he rebels because of something that he did. What did he do? Okay. So God tells him, go fight the Amalekites and destroy them completely. God's order was to kill all the Amalekites, the sheep, the oxen, the women, the children, everything. Everything has to be completely obliterated. Nothing of the in Amalek should be alive. Everything should be killed. And Saul goes for war and he wins the battle. And what does he do? He kills everything. He doesn't kill two things. Okay? Except two things. He's killed the women, the children. Okay? Everybody is killed. Who does he not kill? The king. King Agag, he doesn't kill. And there's one more. Sheep. Why did he not kill the sheep? Yeah. So he thought he would give it to the Lord. That he would sacrifice to God. What God had ordered to be killed, he wanted to sacrifice to God. And what God had told to kill, he did not kill Agag. You know why he didn't kill Agag? Because he thought Agag was such a great king. It would be such a waste to kill this guy. Saul was considered himself wiser than God and Samuel, who had told you should kill everybody. Saul at this point was king for about a year. Do you know how long Saul was king? All of us, you know, keep hearing about Saul. Do you know how long Saul was king? 2 years. It was just 2 years Saul was king. And there's so much written about Saul, we keep thinking it's a long time. But it's not directly given in the Bible. You have to do a lot of study, comparisons, and find out how long Saul was king. It's somewhere between 882 and 884 BC. So only 2 years he was king. And within, when he started to be a king, he was very, very humble. And in about a year, he does this, where he's gained confidence, he wins a few victories. And he thinks he is a good king. He can manage on his own. And he thinks himself to be better than God himself. At that point, he doesn't obey Samuel. He doesn't kill Agag. And the consequences of not killing Agag is seen all through history. All through history. Even as in there are claims, even to this day, the Jewish people suffer because of Agag, the mistake that Saul did. So this is another place where we see rebellion. And all this rebellion that we do, we have all this, we want to fight and break free from authority, is to have freedom. And the problem is we have this weird idea about freedom that is not true. And we will get to this thing. We always think it's freedom from authority. And the biblical way is it's freedom in authority. You will not have freedom if you step out of authority. You can think you have freedom, and that is the myth of absolute freedom. Okay? Nobody has absolute freedom. Absolute freedom is do whatever I want. There are laws of nature which God has put in place that there is no absolute freedom. You can we talk about free will and what God has given us, free will to decide whatever we want to do. All that we can do is only within what God has permitted us to do. I cannot decide the sun will not rise tomorrow and think the sun is not going to rise. There are perimeters to my free will, which is God's permission. I cannot go beyond that. There is no absolute freedom. You can break away from government, from church, from family, whatever you want to go, you will not find freedom. You will be hopelessly lost, just like the prodigal son was. And this concept of absolute freedom also comes with this concept of absolute love. How many of you think there is absolute love? Absolute love is what some people call unconditional love. We often say God has unconditional love for you. Okay? That is also, we can debate over that. God does not have unconditional love. There is a condition that God puts. God gave himself up. There was love before you loved him, but there is a condition for that love. Okay? And there is this concept of absolute love. We think, I will love this person whatever the other person does. That is not love. There is no absolute love. There is no absolute freedom. And you can have freedom only in authority. You cannot get freedom when you get out of the authority that God has placed over your life. So, the world's principle is, there is authority, you rebel, and you get freedom. And Christ's principle is, there is authority, you submit to that authority, and you have freedom that is eternal, that is inside. You have a freedom that the world probably cannot see. You have a peace that passes all understanding. You will not understand why you have peace in a place where you are so oppressed. And that is the peace that Christ gives because of the submission that you have done to the authority that God has put over your life. Okay, so all of us live happily in authority. Is that true? Because authority is in human form, sometimes the authority makes mistakes. Okay? All authorities that God has placed on earth have human form. And the human form is fallen, and because of which the authority makes a mistake. And we have a way to appeal to that. Okay? This is called an appeal. The word itself is very similar to beg. Okay? It is not to tell them what to do, but you are appealing to them. And a lot of people, this is, by the way, only for human authority. A lot of people try appealing to God. God has decided something in your life and has said this is what it is. And we try appealing to God. This is not, appeal is not for God. You can ask God and you can plead with God to change certain things, but God in his goodness has set certain things in your life. You usually don't appeal to God. And you don't want to appeal to God and change and go from his perfect will into the permissive will. Okay? So when you think the authority is wrong, there is a certain set of things that you can do before you go to the authority. Okay? That somebody, children, when you think your dad has put some very strict rule that is not good for you, these are the things that you can look at. First, you have to make sure that your conscience is clear. That you are doing the right thing. That you have the right motive for what you are asking. Second, that is, you're doing the right thing, you have the right motive. Okay, you don't have some ulterior motive to ask for this. I want freedom, you don't let me go anywhere, I want to go for this party, but you want to go to that party because somebody else is coming to that party. Okay, this often happens with young folks. And the right attitude, meaning you have to have an attitude of respect to the authority that is above you. If you throw a tantrum and throw things and at home and expect your father to give in to your request, it's not going to happen. Okay? And I'm giving this father-son or father-daughter relationship but it applies everywhere. At work, if your boss is asking you to do something, throwing a tantrum is not an appeal. Refusing to do your work, showing up late, being tardy at work is not an appeal. And a lot of us try appealing that way. When they give you uninteresting work, you do it badly. And then hoping that they will change the work and give you interesting work. That is not an appeal. The way you appeal is do your work well, go talk to the person directly, tell them this is what you feel. Okay? Discern appropriate time. When the person is hurriedly doing something, that is not the time you go and ask so that they will say, okay, okay, do something and go away. Children know this very well. They will go ask at a time when they cannot refuse. Isaac and Ziva will ask us for certain things when there are guests at home or when we are outside somewhere, when we cannot say no to them. That is the time we also like to do make our appeal. We will make our appeal to our boss when our boss's boss is here. So he cannot say no to us. Okay? So that the appeal has to happen at an appropriate time, not when the boss's boss is there. Find a time. It is not to shame your boss. Okay? So often we have this concept of arm twisting them to give you what you want. We try to arm twist our authority, push them to a corner where they cannot say anything else but give you what you want. That is not appeal. Appeal is to humbly request them to truly change their mind. Only when the authority truly changes their mind and gives you permission with a full heart will you enjoy the freedom that you get from their decision. If you do not do that, if you arm twist them and get them to say what you want to hear, you will not enjoy the freedom that you get. Okay? Then provide accurate information. Children, provide full accurate information. Withholding information is equally bad as lying. So often we will not say the whole truth. Partly we say, and I am going to a movie with my friend. Who is your friend? This girl, you know. There are many other people who are coming, and this girl is actually going to the theater next to you, and you are going with some other guy. And the girl goes and tells her father, I am going to this movie with my friend who you know very well. Okay? That is lying, withholding information. Give full information. Provide reasonable alternatives. Okay? So if the authority is telling you to do something, give them alternatives. Think of reasonable alternatives, not unreasonable ones. And it has to be presented in respectful ways. Finally, even if they don't change their mind, you will still obey the authority. Okay? This is the process of an appeal. And if any of you have trouble with your authority, which all of us have, when you appeal, this is what we need to do. Okay? Not throw a tantrum, not pass sarcastic comments, not disobey them blatantly in front of others, not arm twist them till they tell you what you want to hear, but appeal in the right way. Okay? So I want to finish authority and then go to responsibility. Responsibility is a little short, so we'll finish that. There are many spheres of life that we have. There is family, there is workplace, there is church, and then there is neighborhood, society, wherever you live. And in all of these places, we are asked to submit to authority. So if any of you are taking pictures or taking notes, take these verses. And these are all known verses. Now this we know very well what husband, wife, children are supposed to do. This is Ephesians 5 and 6. Workplace also we know. This verse is very interesting. 1 Peter 2:18. Anybody knows what it is? It's about workplace. No, this is not that verse, but this is, I put this verse specifically for one reason. Can somebody read?
Slaves in bondage fear not,
but also to those who are harsh. Even if the authority above you is harsh, we are supposed to obey them and respect them. Okay? Even if they are faulty, we will still submit to them. Even if they don't behave kind to you, we still will obey and respect them. That is the calling that we have. Government, very relevant for this week and the week before. We've been going through a lot. You can read Romans 13 verses 1 to 8 and it tells you all about how we should submit to authority in government places. And in church, there are lots of passages which says there are elders in church, there are mentors who disciple you, there are people who teach you. All of us have. There are people over us, there are people over our overseer George, there are people over Sam uncle who actually George reports to. Everybody, there is somebody above them all, and they all have to listen to that authority and obey. And church functions in a very similar way. Okay, so the final thing that you need to know is there is an authority above all of this. You might find the authority not competent, authority not good enough, not kind, might be harsh, whatever it is. The comfort that we have is above all the authority that God has placed is Christ Himself. There is no authority above Christ. And He is all-knowing, He is benevolent, and does things for our eternal good, and He is purposeful. He will fulfill our life goal fully. And there are many, many verses for that. And we will get rest and peace only when we understand that Christ is above all the authority that is placed in your life. Even if your authority is doing wrong, leave it for God to correct your authority. Our place is not to correct our authority. Our place is only to appeal to the authority. The person who can correct the authority is the authority above them. Okay? And you need not trust all the authorities above. So at workplace, our company is going through a huge chaotic transition. Our share prices went from $30 last year to $12 this year. So things have plummeted and everything is bad. And all our leaders are crazy. Okay? Absolutely crazy. Each person is out for their own good, doing all kinds of crazy things. And the more you know how they behave, the less you want to trust them, because you see all the flaws coming out, because everybody is under pressure, and in pressure all their bad things are very evident outside. So should I obey my boss when he's doing something? I can find out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 levels up, everybody is hopeless. The only comfort that I have is I know above even that there is Christ, and He will do what is good for me, and He will do what is good for His kingdom. I need to trust this. It's very difficult to trust. Oftentimes I come back very angry about my boss and my boss's boss and my boss's boss's boss, because they are making stupid directional changes. But I need to know that God is sovereign and He is in control. So how do we deal with authority? This is just a summary. These are long sentences. We have to adjust to the established order. Oftentimes, we need adjustment. We stop trying to adjust the order. Adjust so we will fix ourselves to the order that is there. We will obey with willful obedience and respect. If something is not right, we will humbly ask them. And even when we ask them, we submit the respect to God's decision, because God can change the heart of the authority that is put above you. Okay? 10 more minutes and I will finish this. This is biblical responsibility. Okay, my wife is saying it is very long. Okay, I want to finish responsibility today, because otherwise this biblical principles will go on forever and ever. This is not too long. What is responsibility? I don't know if most of you understand this. In the US, if you take your dog out and if your dog poops in the road, you have to clean it. Okay? And I remember when I took my dog out for a walk, there was another guy who was also from another country in the US, and he was walking around with me, and he says, I was picking up my dog's poop and putting it in a bag, and he said, he came to me, he said, stopped and said, if aliens were to come and attack our universe, they will really think the dogs are in control. Okay? They will never understand that the dogs are not in control, that we are in control. Because we are the ones who are going around cleaning up their mess. So this is essentially responsibility. So what is responsibility? It kind of goes hand in hand with authority. You are expected to grow up and act in a way as if the authority is not there. You yourself will become responsible. When are you considered responsible at home, that your parents will let you do what you want, when you can do things the way your parents would? Okay? That is responsibility. If you are able to do what God wants you to do, that is when you become a responsible Christian. One of the things that we often fail to understand is consequence. Cause and effect. If I do something, there is a consequence to it. If I do something wrong, I will have to face the consequence. And there are many, many cases, especially with young people, we don't understand that if we do something, it just doesn't get wiped off. There is a consequence. There is a punishment that will come upon you whatever you do. You can repent, you can cry, you can sob, do whatever you want to do, but the consequence will still be there. Then what did Christ do? What did Christ do? Please don't read this. Can I? There is. So God saved us from eternal consequences. But consequences here on earth are not taken away all the time. Sometimes God in His mercy saves you from the consequence of life here on earth also. There are many testimonies that, you know, we hear in churches where we say, one day I was driving, I was in such a hurry, I saw a red light, I didn't stop, I went and God saved me. God did not save you. By His grace, He probably protected you till you crossed that place. Okay? So that is not what God has called us for. We don't want to. God is not going to save you from the consequence that you face in the short term. So if I put my hand in the snake pit and say, God will save me, not going to happen. Young people, when you make decisions in your life, when you make choices, it is very important to understand, whatever choice you make, don't tell, God is leading me here. You need to understand, you need to be responsible for what you are doing. You cannot do as you like and expect God to come and clean up. He will clean up. I keep saying, God is more interested in your character for eternity than for your happiness here on earth. God really does not care about your happiness here on earth. He is interested in building your character for eternity. So, if you have to get run over by a truck and you lose your leg for the rest of your life, so be it. If you can learn a lesson that you cannot break a law that God has put in place. If that is the only way you learn it, God will allow that. It is a hard lesson even for adults to know this. No, I'm talking as in for young people, but young people don't realize. They think, I will make a mistake, it will be okay. No, I will get something out of it, and then in the end it is never okay. You saw Saul's mistake. There are studies which show how Saul not killing all the Amalekites had led to the Holocaust. The Jewish people still suffer for that one mistake that Saul did. And even biblically, there is an Agagite which comes in the book of Esther. The only person who's called an Agagite is Haman, who wanted to destroy all the Jews. And that is because Saul did not kill King Agag. So one mistake will have serious repercussions down history, not only in your lifetime, but down history. This is a law that God has put in place. We cannot undo this. So there will be consequences here on earth that we will face for our actions. God has saved us from eternal consequences. God in His mercy might save us from some of the earthly consequences, but not always. Okay, so that is one thing. Anybody remembers the Delhi 2012 rape case, the Nirbhaya case? Anybody following it up? Anybody knows something that happened recently? On May 5th, the Supreme Court upheld the death penalty for the four rapists. There was an appeal made by the rapists to the Supreme Court, and they said, what do you gain by our deaths? Wouldn't it be better if you gave mercy to us? This is the appeal that they made. Okay? And if, I don't know if all of you followed the case of what happened to Nirbhaya during that time, how she died, and if you followed that, and you're following, I'm not going to go into a debate of whether death penalty is Christian or not, but I'm asking you to think about the appeal that these four people made to the Supreme Court and how irresponsible it is to make that appeal. If one of us or any of us had made a mistake like that, would you be appealing? Would you appeal, or would you just accept what is done to you in shame? Okay. Before you make up your mind on this, the atrocity that we did to Christ by our sins is much, much greater than what these four men did to that girl. And often we make an appeal. And when we make an appeal to God, giving an excuse for our behavior, we are being much more irresponsible than these four guys who've done something unimaginable and then make an appeal to the court saying, you will not gain anything by killing us. So I have some more stuff on responsibility. It is attached to freedom, and there are many more theological things that, you know, we can talk about. But there is one thing that I want to say is, it all comes back to love. God does not want us to be responsible because of a sense of duty. God did not come and save humanity because He had a sense of duty towards us. He came to save because He loved us. And we will get true responsibility only when there is love in our hearts for God and for the people around us. Unless we have that love that God gives us, we will not be accountable or responsible. Can we pray? Father God, we thank you this morning for showing us the order of things that